Good morning. Thank you for all coming out today. Can you all hear me in the cheap seats? Okay. I'm Tom Ricks. I'm with New America's Future of War Project, and I write books for a living. Our guest today is Eric SCHMIDT. You all know as Mr. Google, also Mr. Former Chairman of New America. He's here because he's been running a panel looking into innovation in the military for the Pentagon, and we're going to focus on that today. I'm going to begin by asking him a few questions, and then we're going to go to the audience, and you can throw your hardballs at him. First, though, I want to ask a poll question. Our polling question has to do with the subject we're about to discuss. It is this. Which innovation area should the U.S. focus most on for future military advantage? A, hardware robots. B, software, artificial intelligence, cyber. C, waveware, that is energy weapons. D, wetware, that is biosciences and human performance enhancements. And it looks like software is the Iran of this one. How long are we supposed to give this? Okay, we're cutting it off. Eric, you've been running this panel looking at the Pentagon and defense and innovation. What are your two or three big takeaways from that?
Well, first, thank you for having me. Thank you for supporting this. Thank you all for coming. I want to thank the sort of New America and the ASU folks for putting this thing together. As I've gotten more and more involved trying to understand what we're up to, I think it could not be a better use of everybody's time. And Tom, you've got a new book coming out on Churchill and Orwell, so let me give a shameless plug to your new book, having read many of your earlier ones. I do, right, big deal, right? When is it published?
May 23rd.
Okay. I'm sure you can pre-order it.
You can pre-order it on Amazon. And by the way, that really helps with the first week numbers for the bestseller list.
By the way, mine is being introduced tomorrow morning, so I'm ahead of you. I also need, I want to read a disclaimer, though, just to make sure we're all proper here. I put together, at the request of the DOD, a group that visited up to 20-ish sites around the world, so I have a lot of opinions now, but I'm not speaking for the department or for the Defense Innovation Board. Anything I say here will be my personal views as a private citizen, and I've studied it for a long time. So with that, your question was, what are the two or three most important takeaways? I think the biggest takeaway is that you guys got it right, and the single overwhelming conclusion you come to, speaking as a person who sort of wandered around, is that the Defense Department, broadly speaking, is run in many ways like a 1980s corporation. There's not very much software being used, and it feels that way. So we were asked to sort of come in and look at how were external companies run, technology innovation, and how is the DoD, and the lack of software, and in particular the lack of computer science, is a real problem to be addressed. And that recommendation has been well heard and is being listened to today by the military. We actually made 10 or 11 recommendations, which are public, and we have a public process. They were released in January, and you can just type Defense Innovation Board and you'll read all about them with a lot of justification.
One of your recommendations was to have a chief innovation officer. The Pentagon already has a chief technology officer. What's the difference?
Because the DoD is run in this sort of classic old way, the internal procedures that it has that are not, I don't know how to say it, they're very long in planning, right? So they plan over a decade. And the culture does not have a culture around rapid prototyping at sort of any level. And so our idea was that you could take a chief innovation officer and put that person in to basically try to get these systems to be more responsive to innovation, quicker product cycles, and so forth. And this is true at every level of the military, whether it's the HR systems, the transportation systems, the weapon systems, everything that they do.
It sounds to me like you're describing a problem that's more cultural than technological. Is that correct?
Well, innovation is always a cultural problem, and it's a management problem, it's a cultural problem, it's a technological problem, it's a money problem. So there are, for example, groups in the DoD that are doing exactly the right things, and they need more support, right? More political support, more funding, and so forth. Just a big bureaucracy. But what happens in having now run a number of very large corporations, the culture tends to determine the outcome. And so when you go and talk in detail with the military, what they'll talk about is their own view of how the culture works, which in the military is largely determined by their promotion capabilities, where they're reviewed, risk intolerance and risk tolerance, risk seeking, who's in charge, that kind of stuff. It's obviously very hierarchical.
How do you make the military bureaucracy less risk averse?
Well, one of our recommendations is to make it, it's a bit of background. There's this process generally known as AT&L. And the people in the audience who've been in the military will know a great deal about this. And it's rumored to be a couple thousand pages. No single person seems to understand it. So, and people spend all day complaining about the process, right? And this is how the weapon systems are purchased, is how everything is purchased. It drives the planning processes, and the organizations that implement it are highly centralized and very, very rule-bound. So that's an area, that's a target-rich environment from our perspective. And so we wandered around and we said, well, this is clearly a problem. So the AT&L people call back and say, well, there are a gazillion waivers. You just have to ask for them. I said, what? You can waive this stuff? Yeah, it's in the document. You know, page 697. So we found the document. We found the paragraph. And indeed, it's true that using good judgment, the military can actually do the right thing, right, from our perspective. And so one of the recommendations that we have made is to have much more extensive use of waivers. And it's interesting that, again, the military leadership is very sensitive to this. One of the more interesting things that the senior leadership did is with the B-21, they actually used a rapid acquisition process rather than a more cumbersome process, which was controversial. But that's an example of innovation within the bureaucracy that that I certainly hope will produce a better outcome.
And last question from me for the moment. If you were king of the Pentagon for a day, is there one change you would make in how the U.S. military approaches this problem? Personnel policy, education, whatever.
Well, I should say that the people we've met are incredibly impressive. I don't know about you all, but when you spend time in there, the leadership skills, the training, the level of education, the commitment to serve the mission, it's all very good. The systems are just sort of, I'll just say, horrific. And an example is that there's this process called the Program of Record. Basically, it's called the POM. And it's a two-year planning cycle. And during that two-year planning cycle, you have to budget things for 2+ years from now. And then it's 10 years after that. And it's very difficult if you're doing rapid acquisition, rapid software, rapid iteration, to figure how to fit in that. So I would start by attacking that problem and insert this sort of rapid prototyping model. One of our recommendations is to build a culture of rapid prototyping and experimentation. When you talk to the generals and admirals, they say they're frustrated, right? These are people who want to do the right thing. And they'll say, yeah, I want to do that. But then I have to adhere myself to that, to this process, which is sort of turgid, would be the best description. And so I say, well, okay, I mean, I do this with a little bit more respect, but I'll say something to the effect of, you're a general, you're in charge, why can't you do this? And then they'll look at me, and I say this very politely, and they'll give a very polite back answer, which is, I tried, right? What I did is I cut this budget, I made this more flexible, and the moment I did that, the money that I had saved was taken away from me. Right? That's a disincentive to taking risk. That's a classic bureaucratic problem, by the way. So creating a space of not just, and by the way, we're not talking about a lot of money here in the Pentagon numbers, small amounts of money. And one of the beauties about the survey that you all did about software is relatively inexpensive compared to the many other things the military does.
Okay, we're going to go to audience questions. Do the people wielding the microphones have them ready? While the microphones are getting ready, I just want to mention In World War II, George Marshall, the Army Chief of Staff, was at a meeting in which the Army was represented by a general, the Navy was represented by an admiral, and the Air Force was represented by a major. And it was pointed out to him that this was kind of inappropriate to have a major arguing for the Army Air Force. And he said, "You're right." He promoted him to Brigadier General immediately. Okay, audience questions? Over here, please.
Hi, Ted Johnson and Eric and Wendy Smith Fellow here at New America, so thank you for that.
Thank you. I'm glad you're here.
Me too.
That was not a plant, by the way.
Right. I'm also a retired Navy commander and recently wrote about how military bases can bring smart technology to sort of streamline base operations. Naturally, the initial concern is about security. So as we think about how to incorporate more technology, software, hardware, et cetera, for military applications, how do you address the real security concern of attaching thousands of wireless sensors to military infrastructure and protecting them from hackers and other vulnerabilities?
Well, indeed, thank you, and thank you for working with New America. One of our recommendations as a group was to focus on this question of cyber more thoroughly. I'll just use my own language. I am concerned that outside of the secure networks, which have a pretty good, I'll just say generically, a pretty good approach to trying to be secure, the non-secure networks, which is where the majority of the military activity is, these are the unclassified networks, how do we know that they're secure? And I'll give you an example, a specific example. Many of the cyber attacks are done on downrev Windows machines, and the military has lots of downrev Windows machines. So the military has recently announced that it's going to upgrade all those to Windows 10. It's a reasonable decision. However, they are not upgrading at the same time the systems, the PCs that are inside the program of record weapon systems and other systems. So here's an example where they're trying to do the right thing, but it's such a massive problem, it creates a vulnerability. So one solution here would be, I mean, there are many solutions. One solution would be to try to create, and we recommend this, some kind of a facility inside the military or appropriate place that can really go and address the question you asked. It's a specialized problem. I agree with it. However, it's not an excuse to not automate the bases. Right. The standard joke about the nuclear stuff is the nuclear stuff is not hackable because it was all the software was done in 1970, and it's still stored on 8-inch floppy disks, which you can't purchase anymore. Right? Not a good answer, by the way. That's sort of the joke. Right? I'm not endorsing that as a cyber strategy.
Guy with the beard who looks like Andrew Exum.
Let's get some mics over here if you have mics as well, if you have multiple mics.
Thanks, Zach Biggs with Janes. I wanted to ask you, the last administration with Secretary Carter, innovation was a huge priority. He opened the three branches of DIUX. You can look at several different major speeches he made on innovation. And some of the travel that you mentioned you've done to bases and facilities were with him. He was on those trips, so secretary level issue. Does the new administration view it with that same sense of urgency from what you've seen thus far? And is there any difference in the approach you're seeing from the new administration? I grant there are a lot of open jobs, AT&L's open, et cetera, but do they view it from a different viewpoint?
I haven't seen any change so far. In other words, it looks to me like the same problems, same actors, same recommendations. I would probably say that our recommendations were designed to be independent of who the leadership are. I think these are generic. They're not specific to any particular leadership approach. So I haven't seen much of a change. Same focus on this. I think at some point there'll be some kind of crisis that will sort of bring this into form. Maybe it's a budget crisis or a military crisis or something. That's usually how it happens.
Speaking of the new administration, if President Trump called you into the Oval Office and asked you what the next war would look like, what would you tell him?
You know, there's a sort of, The military doctrine on strategy is pretty well set, and it's fairly well set from a long historic reasoning. So the nuclear triad, all of those things, which are horrific and terrifying, by the way, so we're clear, and the need for an army, navy, and so forth and so on. What is missing is what radical innovation could occur that would change war, conflict, and also defensive positions. Bob Work, who's the departing deputy secretary, has a thing called the third offset, where he talks about autonomy, right, in particular, and artificial intelligence. And that, my guess is that's where the real problems would come from, that we, if we don't invest in those areas. And the reason is that our competitors, I'll just use the word competitor for lack of a better term, are clearly investing in these areas, right? Whether it's cyber, autonomy, who's the largest manufacturer of autonomy, right? The Chinese with DJI. So we need to really think about, we have a whole recommendation about this, and I want to stick on recommendations. It's important that the military make AI and machine learning a component of their work, right? We looked pretty hard to find such groups, and there's a few people here and a few people there who are valiantly trying to do this, but it's not part of the core competency. Whereas you can imagine if you were to, let's just go do it. One of the things you do when you look at change in an organization is imagine you didn't have the organization at all. You had no people at all. Just do the thought experiment. Of course, it was not really going to happen. What are the things that you would build, right? How, what would you do first? And I think one of the first things you would do is try to use artificial intelligence and machine learning to change the way people think about deterrence. An example which I've used publicly in other forums is the question of who has advantage in cyber war. In traditional conflict, the attacker has advantage because of the advantage of surprise, right? And you know, you don't know what's coming, you have all these people monitoring, you know, oh my God, you know, this thing's coming, we have to react to it, and then you react. That's typically how it works in any form of human contest. But in the AI world, training matters. It may very well be that well-designed cyber defense systems are stronger than the attacker systems. Because the defense systems are constantly being trained by the attacks that are coming. So anyway, we focused a great deal in our report on the importance of becoming expert at this. Indeed, this is one of the recommendations that has been adopted so far. We'll see how far the military gets in this.
On artificial intelligence, I'd like to ask you a Rosa Brooks question. Not that she placed this, but that I think she would ask it, and I would too if I were as smart as she is. So, can humans hope to ever fight against autonomous weapons?
Well, the general, again, speaking generically, it just seems like, I should say that the military has told me that their doctrine is that the human is always in the loop. That's what they've told me.
Isn't that a recipe for disaster?
I'm not going to comment on that. They've told me that's their position, right? If you have an autonomous attacker, you're going to want to have an autonomous defensive system, right? Mm-hmm. And if you think about autonomy, again, would the defender have more advantage than the attacker? It may be because of training. Right. And that's a concept that, for background for those of you who don't know about it, today computer vision is better than human vision, and machine learning allows you to recognize patterns more accurately and more depth than humans can. And we all operate as humans with sort of reasoning and common sense, all the things that got us to where we are today, but in fact, the revolution that's going on in my industry is because the algorithms, technically deep neural networks, are so good at recognizing these patterns. So for example, the ability to have automatic translation between languages, something we do very well now, recognition of images. Much of what governments do is in fact pattern matching, right? So what does a security guard do? What does a military guard with a gun do? They're all about what does the submariner who's looking at video of underwater footage looking for mines or other things underwater that could threaten the ship. Those are all vision problems. When you go to the doctor, what does the dermatologist do? It's a vision problem, right? Well, we have technology that can do a better job, equal or better job than almost every dermatologist using vision. Now, it doesn't replace the dermatologist, it just makes the dermatologist better. So I think the general theme here is since this is about the military, if the military were to adopt these things, the humans would be more accurate in terms of watching, monitoring, you know, being ready, which is part of readiness is a big thing within the military.
This hadn't occurred to me before, but listening to you, for the last 60 or so years, the offense has predominated in warfare. The last time we had a war in which the defense predominated was World War I. It sounds to me like you're describing a terrific war of attrition in which victory goes to the side with the ability to sustain itself economically and demographically. Is that the war you're describing to Mr. Trump?
Again, I want to be specific on where the technology can take things. And I think the biggest innovations in the next 20 years will be in this area of machine learning, AI, autonomy, right? And America is in a very strong position to be a leader here, right? We have all the best people, we have this huge industry, and I think that part of why we were asked to work with the DoD was try to get some of those ideas in.
Okay, the right wing has some questions over here. I think the guy standing against with his back against the wall.
Thank you. I'd like to follow up on the human capital question. When you look at, my name is Mark Hagler, I'm a cyber fellow here, but I also served on the Defense Science Board study of autonomy, long service in the military, now I'm an academic. when we had the Industrial Revolution, we had to create entirely new educational institutions, West Point, Thomas Jefferson, the Navy responded to mechanical engineering. You look at the companies that you led, Apple led, they weren't a knockoff on Kodak, they weren't a knockoff on Honeywell computers, they were something entirely new. Is it time to build a AI cyber force with the institutions from the 18-year-old all the way at new culture to augment West Point, Air Force, the Navy, the Army? But time for a new force that gets to those rapid culture adaptation that right now probably is just too slow.
So again, that would be something for the military to decide how to do it. But we made a strong recommendation to essentially invest in both computer science and AI as a core competency for precisely that reason. There are a number of initiatives within the military already that need to be to get a lot more support. It was earlier mentioned something called DIUX, which is a group that essentially takes military money and advances companies in partnership that will help the military reach its mission. And they're essentially, if you will, providing additional capital to the private sector to jumpstart the ability for the military to purchase those activities. So that's a big deal. There's another one called SCO, or Strategic Capabilities Office. It's run by a guy named Will Roper, a true hero in my view. And what they do is they take the existing systems of the military and they lengthen their lifespan by adding software autonomy and things like that. So again, solving a very tactical problem, but one which is, you know, sort of serious. So those are two that the military has already. I think any form of your idea, right, whether it's a center, a building, and so forth, makes sense. Another idea that we had was just have every major command have a software group that's under command of the commander, right? So the military is full of the following problem. You have screen A and screen B, and you have human. And the human spends all day, a very well-trained soldier typically, copying the data from screen A to screen B, right? Because the systems don't coordinate each other. So in traditional systems, you know, the first thing in a turnaround CEO, the first thing that CEO would do is go and raise some capital, replace those systems, automate everything, and get huge efficiencies in the system. So from my perspective, any form of adding software people into the commands and into some sort of university makes sense. I'll give you an analogy. The military nuclear work is done not by the DoD, but by the DOE labs. So we visited them as part of our normal visiting. and I knew very little about this area. And I was struck by the level and scale of what our nation built and invested in way back when, right? Now, we're not at the same level, and I'm not suggesting we have to have Sandia and, you know, Kirkland and all of that kind of stuff. But my point is, here you've got a clear problem, a clear opportunity. It's pervasive across our nation's things, and not just military, but everywhere, right? You would want to have a set of buildings, a set of programs analogous to what you described.
And also, you didn't mention it, but one of your recommendations was that ROTC have a specific computer track of computer sciences.
Well, again, we go on to, there's plenty of technical work going on in the DoD, and there's plenty of people who want to come in as young technical people who want to serve the nation, you know, and so forth. There's something called the Defense Digital Service, which is another one of these early programs where, again, software and people will come in. I think if the DoD identifies this as a major priority, the capitalist system around it, which is basically the contractors and the consultants and so forth, will respond, will get themselves educated up to what you're describing. I like your idea, and I think we should propose that one as well. Of course.
It does amaze me that, to my knowledge, there is still not a reserve unit in Silicon Valley for information warfare operations. I mean, you'd see any service chief who wanted to pick up some cheap talent. I mean, my college roommate was nuts, but he became an executive at Apple. And if you told him he could shoot a 50 caliber machine gun once a year and do a couple of hours a month of helping out, he'd be happy to. But nobody's ever asked him. I saw Aaron Simpson had a question.
Thanks, Tom. Aaron Simpson, until recently, was the CEO of Karis Associates, which was a research and consulting firm, did a lot of work with the Defense Department, including DARPA. And as a business person, I'd like your thoughts on why both small and large companies should want to do business with the Pentagon. There are incredible compliance costs and margins. It's not the easiest place to work.
Well, in fact, we have a recommendation on that. How perfectly asked. I omitted to say that my career and my world is largely due to DARPA, right? So you go back to Bob Taylor as a leader of DARPA in 1965, 66, 67, and the funding that he did that ultimately created the industry that we live in. I mean, I worked for Bob, so I know this is all true. These are extraordinary moments in American history. So let's thank DARPA for, among other things, helping create the computer industry. One of our recommendations, as a bit of background, working with the military as a procurement matter is very difficult. And one of our recommendations is to move to the cloud, right? But we don't mean the military cloud. We mean use commercial cloud phenomena. So you say, seems perfectly reasonable. After all, for non-classified work, the military is just a big business in that sense. And yet it's extraordinarily difficult because of all sorts of strange rules that don't make any sense, right? At least from my perspective, speaking as the outsider. And so that's an example where if the military were to move to more standard ways of interacting and operating so that they can look like a large corporation for their non-classified work, that's a big deal. It changed the way they acknowledged, it changed the way they would, and indeed, this is one of our recommendations.
Okay, we have a centrist question here. If we can run a mic up to the guy in the bow tie.
Will Duffield, London School of Economics. Human-machine interfacing and biological enhancement will alter both how we fight wars, but also how our servicemen will be injured in them. How can we best anticipate and prepare to care for the casualties of future wars before we see them coming home?
There's a lot of assumptions in your series of questions. So one is that it looks like deaths by conflict are actually declining, right, globally, right? So it's obviously a good thing. However, the advent of more precision means a much more precise outcome, right? And there are just horrific scenarios that you can go through in your mind. So I don't know how to answer your question except to say that there are people who are working on human augmentation and so forth, but I think the correct answer is to figure out how a way not to have conflict, right? It's just, it's always a bad outcome. And based on, again, speaking as the outsider, people get used to these things, I guess. But when you look at the capability of human fighting human, we really want to be against it, right? Just do the math.
David Wood has written a book that gets into a lot of that. David, do you have a comment you want to add to that?
I'm not sure what the interface is between combat stress and combat stress injuries and cyber war. So I'd be interested in your thoughts on that, if any.
Well, Jared Cohen and I wrote a book about the sort of the new digital age and how wars would get started, right? And as part of this, we talked about the fact that it's possible for countries that are at peace to have cyber conflicts, right? Because there's relatively little deterrence and so forth. We see that today with the Russian and Chinese scenario, where we're clearly not, you know, quote, war, unquote, and yet both countries have done things to America that we're upset about. And analogously, and I don't know this, we weren't read in on this, but I'm assuming that America did things that annoyed them no end as well. And yet we tolerate that. So cyber, at least at the level of peacetime, if you will, may be a different kind of animal, if you will, strategically. And I don't think we know. There's been lots of discussion about what's it like to be a drone pilot, remote, so forth and so on. I won't comment on that. But I think these are new problems to be researched.
One new problem I've seen in the field is in the initial steps of a war, like the invasion of Iraq in 2003, American soldiers experienced for the first time in their lives extreme information deprivation. Mm-hmm. For the first time in their lives, they have no screens to look at. They have no cell phones. They have no computers at night. And they seem to me to go through a form of information starvation. They are not stimulated by the things that normally get their brain going. Early in the Iraq invasion in 03, I would show up at checkpoints with my big, heavy satellite phone. I think the company would bust. I can't remember what they're named. But it was my big satellite phone. And I would offer it to the soldiers who want to call home for 60 seconds to say, hi, Mom. And to them, it was like, it was much more meaningful than just a phone call. It was being reconnected to the real world. Mm-hmm. It's what they called in Vietnam the big PX. I think now it's the big database.
So one of our recommendations is to make computing and bandwidth abundant. We traveled around and talked to the folks who were just doing normal jobs in the DoD. And they spend a good deal of their time emptying their mailbox of mail because the mail system is so primitive, right? These problems were solved a long time ago. I know that's trivial, but if you're a soldier on deployment, this is a really big deal. And the technology now allows to have essentially abundant computing and abundant communications around the world. In general, the military communication systems are rare and expensive. And that's true in general of military things, because of this lack of iteration, and sort of the building a small number of big, beautiful, and very expensive things, as opposed to a large number of things which are far more common, which again is endemic in the approach that the military uses. They don't have those kinds of solutions. I think your scenario in 2003 can be addressed now by much better connectivity, but the principle is correct, that we recommend very strongly that everyone in the DoD is a knowledge worker too, right? And knowledge workers need access to information, knowledge, sharing, and so forth and so on.
The downside is you need extreme information discipline of a sort we've never had, especially in American units. If I'm the enemy military intelligence commander, I wanna know what frequencies those cell phones are operating on.
But those things are easily, in general, almost all of these problems can be solved by very strong encryption. Mm-hmm. So again, the way you would solve, and this is a generic statement about companies, all of you should be using two-factor authentication. And I can give you lots of examples of people who are unhappy because they didn't. All of you should be using Chrome, by far the best browser. It's also free, okay, so it's the right price, right? So a simple list of cyber rules of that category would go a very long way.
But I'm not just worried about secrecy. I'm just saying omissions become a target.
Understood.
And especially worries me when embedded reporters don't understand signals and start using unencrypted devices in the field and get us all killed.
So again, in the computer world, in my industry, we've all moved to fully encrypted HTTPS. And so when you are using the internet, you're on a very encrypted communication as long as you're using modern technology and so forth. It's funny that not all the military does that.
Right? And newsrooms are cheap. I remember being laughed at the first time I asked for body armor. You know, what would you need that for, my editor said. Way in the back here, wave your hand. There you go.
Thank you. Hi, Eric. Jody Shelton, and I'm the president of the Global Semiconductor Alliance. I am curious as to whether or not your role with the DoD has adversely affected Google or Apple in your global business, when oftentimes that means dealing with foreign governments. It certainly means being geographically neutral much of the time. And conversely, does the DoD think that it's strange to have a global leader as part of their team?
Well, I can't speak for them how we appear to them. They probably think of us sort of like the Silicon Valley show. But you know, who knows? We're just trying to do the best we can. We've been pretty careful to identify ourselves as trying to bring technological and business ideas to the military, but not telling the military what to do. We're not in charge, we're not part of it. That's why I give my disclaimer. And so far that's been fine. And we have representatives on our board from pretty much every Silicon Valley company. Jeff Bezos is on the board. Just lots of interesting scientists and so forth. So I think there's not been an issue so far.
Guy was standing at the table right behind you.
Thank you. I'm Zachary Schnall. I'm a graduate student at the University of Kentucky studying security and intelligence matters. A lot of what you've talked about to this point hits upon sort of broader organizational steps, I feel like. In the earlier panels, they seemed to discuss networking more as a way of integrating the force, or rather developing sort of a more mobile, agile unit in sort of a battlefield context. Do any of the recommendations you have sort of touch on the battle space aspect, making the force more effective in terms of communication?
So the military has a strong view on this, which I'm just going to label as data fusion, right? And so the military way of expressing this is that you have all the sensors, you take all this data, big data, and so forth. We listened to that for a while, and we said, well, we don't think you're on your way to building that. In other words, that's what you want, right? But so our recommendations are, in our view, the necessary conditions to create that vision if that's what the military wants. So in particular, you need connectivity. You need data systems that can carry the data. The sensors and so forth generate an enormous amount of data, which they don't do anything with. So a typical example is you've got all of this information coming in, and it gets lost, gets stored and forgotten and so forth. Nobody knows what to do with it. And there's no programmers to take it and analyze it. So again, you don't have any of the normal big data scenarios that a company would have. One of the recommendations that we are considering making, we have a meeting on April 4th, everybody here is invited to. It's at the Pentagon, 2-hour meeting, and we have our meetings in public. We're gonna have a discussion about, should we make a recommendation about what to do about this big data problem? Right, because we keep encountering it over and over again. My own view is that that some centers around big data need to get formed. You need to get some software people. You need to start figuring out what the data is useful for. And I should say that I think this problem, in fact, going out on a limb, I would say that the majority of our recommendations would apply to the US government in general. In other words, I suspect that if you visit kind of any other department of the government, you'd find a lack of cyberspace awareness, a lack of computer scientists, a lack of proper systems, an over-reliance on down-rev systems, lots of information being leaked to competitors and adversaries and so forth because the systems aren't properly architected. I think this is a generic list in that sense.
We're down to a precious few final moments. One question I want to step back and ask is a broad one. What's the biggest global trend you see out there that is under-recognized?
I spend most of my time thinking about what happens when you adopt an AI-first strategy in a business. And AI-first meaning taking the systems that we have built so far and using the technologies that I've been describing here to make the systems more effective. And in Google's case, that would be ads and search and how can you use these systems to hire better people? Can you use these to promote people better and so forth and so on? So I think that the people are generally aware in this room probably that this is coming, but I think most people don't appreciate how profound it can improve whatever you're doing. So healthcare is an easy one. It looks like the computers are very good now at the following. They can have a series of numbers and they can predict the next one, right? You go, well, that's not very interesting, Eric. By the way, that's exactly what happens when you go to a hospital, right? You take your EHR record, right? And with enough data and enough training, we can predict why you've come to the hospital and more importantly, your mortality and morbidity scenario, which is what the doctors really care about. So whether it's in healthcare, which we all care about, or information markets, which I care a great deal about, or whether it's the military, which is the conversation we're having, I don't think people understand how profoundly transformative in almost all a good way this technology is. And so I guess I would leave you with our core recommendations are fundamentally about this, right? To change the way the processes work, build this as a core competency, try to understand how it affects the, this is a future of war conference, how does it affect war? And I think that's a very good thing to do for the next year or two.
Our time is up.
And thank you.
I'm the only thing standing between you and lunch. So, but before you run for the doors, please give Eric SCHMIDT a big hand.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, Tom.
Thank you.